This is Coding Math, Episode 15, Springs, Part 1. And now we get down to what is personally one of my most favorite physics concepts to code, springs and Hooke's Law. Now Hooke's Law says, as the extension, so the force. This is not Star Wars. This means that the force required to extend or compress a spring a certain distance is proportional to that distance. This also winds up saying that the amount of force that spring will exert to return to its rest state is also proportional to that distance. In other words, if you stretch a spring out a little way, it will pull back a small amount. Stretch it out further, it pulls back harder. The further you stretch it, the more it pulls back. Of course, in the real world, there are limits to this. Stretch a spring far enough, and it will eventually either bend or break. This is kind of like the inverse of a force like gravity. With gravity, the further away you get from a massive body like a planet, the less gravity is exerted. In fact, the force of gravity is reversely proportional to the square of the distance, so it decreases rapidly on a curve. But with springs, the force increases as you move away from the source, and it increases linearly. Pull a spring out twice as far, and you'll experience twice the force. Okay, so far, so what? What's so cool about this that I call it my favorite? Well, as you'll soon see, this is very easy to code and produces incredibly dynamic, realistic, and potentially interactive effects. I think you'll be amazed at the number of lifelike types of motion and forms that can be created so simply with this technique. Now, the formula for Hooke's Law is simply F equals KX. F is the resultant force. K is a constant that represents the stiffness of the spring, and x represents the distance that the spring is stretched. The constant is usually some smaller fraction, say 0.2. The force will be an acceleration vector. Now let's see what this looks like. Say we have an object here that's attached to a spring here. Now, for the sake of simplicity, let's imagine that this spring will shrink to a length of 0. So that if the object comes to rest on the spring, it will be sitting right here at this point. But right now it's stretched out this far. Now let's say that the constant is 0.2. This makes the force applied by the spring 0.2 times this distance. And that's a vector pointing this way with a magnitude of something like this. Now assuming that the object's velocity was 0 to start with, after the first frame, its velocity is now the same as this initial force vector. So it'll move to here. Now the spring is stretched out this far. 0.2 times that amount gives us a force like this. Now that's less than last time, but it's still more acceleration that gets added to the object's current velocity. The velocity now looks like this. So the spring is pulling on the object with less force, but it's still pulling. So the object is still speeding up. On the next frame, the object moves to this position, and it's that much closer to the source of the spring. So the spring is still pulling on the object, but only with a tiny amount of force. But this still increases the velocity, if only very slightly. Now the object is moving so fast that it flies right past the source point of the spring, and its position is now over on this side. The spring is now stretched out in this direction, and it's pulling the object back this way. It's not stretched very far, so it's only a small pull, but it does have the effect of reducing the speed of the object. So the object is now moving a little bit slower, but still pretty fast. So now it moves all the way to here. Now because this distance is much further, the spring is pulling much harder on the object, reducing its speed significantly. Eventually, the object slows down almost completely, at which point it's at its furthest point from the spring and starts moving back in the other direction. And the whole cycle repeats back and forth until the object finally settles down. At least that's what happens in the real world. We might see something a bit different when we get coding, so let's get coding. Now here we have the standard animation template in a file called spring1.js. And the HTML file will include the particle, vector, and util.js files. We'll start with a variable called springPoint. This will be a vector used to represent position. will set its X and Y to the center of the canvas. Then we'll add a variable for the object. We'll call it weight, and it will be a particle. Its position will be random, and it won't have any velocity to start with. We'll give this weight a radius of 20 pixels. The last variable we'll create is k, the spring constant. We'll set this to 0.1 for now. Now in the update function, after we clear the canvas, we need to get a vector that goes between the weight and the spring point. The length of this vector will be the distance between the two points. Since spring point is a vector and weight.position is a vector, we can subtract them and get the vector that points from one to the other. Now remember, Hooke's law says that the force of a spring is the spring constant times the distance. Well, since we're using vectors here, we can simply multiply the distance by k and get a new vector that is the force the spring is applying to the object. And now that we have that, we can just add that to the weight's velocity. And that's it. Now we just call weight update and draw a circle for the weight. And maybe another smaller circle for the spring point. And why not just draw a line between them while we're in here? Okay, it's time to test this. Well, we sort of have a spring. It's definitely bouncing back and forth here, but it never settles down. So what are we missing? In the real world, the object would be losing some momentum due to air resistance, other mechanical forces, and the heat energy that's lost in the expansion and contraction of the spring. We can easily simulate that by giving the weight a bit of friction. Set it to 0.9 for now. And test this again. And that's more like it. Now we have a fairly realistic spring. It's attracted to that spring point, and eventually settles down right there. We can make it a bit more realistic by giving the weight some initial random velocity. We'll give it a velocity length of 50 in a random direction. Now it springs around in an elliptical path, but still settles on the spring point. Now at this point, I suggest that you play around with the values for k and friction. By varying k from around 0.9 down to something very close to 0.0, you can simulate all kinds of spring stiffnesses. Higher numbers are more stiff, lower numbers more loose. If you go too high, though, the spring will eventually spring unrealistically far on each iteration. 1.0 would be a theoretically perfect spring. It would pull the object to the spring point in a single iteration. Beyond that, it's pulling harder than it possibly could, and eventually gets unstable and kind of freaks out. The best values seem to be around 0.1 to 0.5. Combine different k values with different friction values, and you can create all kinds of springs with different feels. Spend a while playing with these two values to get an idea for them. Now, this is all pretty cool if you ask me, but it can get even cooler. Right now, the spring point is a fixed point, but there's no reason it has to be. Let's try making the weight spring to the mouse pointer. We'll have to listen to the mouse move event. In that, all we have to do is set spring points x and y to the mouse x and y, based on the event client x and y. That's all. And let's see what that looks like. Pretty cool, right? In fact, I'd even say it's the bee's knees. I'd say it's wicked pissa, but if you didn't grow up in New England in the 70s, you might not know what that means. Anyway, that's it for today. Next week, we'll look at some more advanced things you can do with springs. See you then.